Hey guys, Dylan again, and let's jump right into the video.
The first thing you're doing wrong is maneuvering your clips in an inefficient way. In part one, we went over using the grave key, also known as the tilde key, to move your clips about freely. Here's some more similar tips for you. Chances are that you probably know that by pressing T, which brings up your trim tool, you can perform a slip edit, which allows you to find a later or earlier part of your clip easily. Once again, you can hold the grave key to prevent this connected media from moving with it. The slip edit doesn't change the clip's position on the timeline or the duration, it just changes what part of that clip is shown. Quick side tip, if you hold down T instead of just clicking it, once you stop pressing the key and you let go, it'll go back to the previous tool you were using. This also works for whatever tool you'd like to use, by the way. You can also perform what is called a slide edit by either pressing or holding T and clicking Option while you drag the clip that you want to move on the timeline. The slide edit allows you to move a clip between clips without creating a gap. Stay with me now because this is something I use a lot. So say you've decided that this B-roll clip would be better off in your primary storyline. Tidy things up a bit by pressing Option, Command, and down arrow with that clip selected. If you have a clip that you'd like above the primary storyline, do the opposite shortcut. So Option, Command, and up arrow. The second thing you're doing wrong is not utilizing the video or audio animation editors to adjust the effects of your video or audio clips. So check this out. I have the muffled sound effect applied to this clip. I want to make it so it gradually becomes more muffled as he walks up to the tree. I could make the adjustments by hitting the keyframe button in the inspector window, but I am a visual person. Maybe you are too. So for me, this is the way to go about it. Right-click the sound effect that has the effect on it and hit Show Audio Animation or press the shortcut Ctrl-A. Hit this drop-down menu and whenever you want to place keyframes, you'll press the shortcut Option-K. So I'll hit Option-K where I want the muffled sound effect to start occurring, and then I'll set another keyframe where I want the audio effect to be at full level. Then I'll lower this to the bottom so there's no muffled effect here. I'll raise up the amount of the muffled effect here, and you'll notice that now we have a very gradual introduction of that effect. If I want, I can move these around to make it more gradual or less gradual, and obviously moving these lines up or down changes the amount of the effect. Then just hit this X when you're done. I find that the audio animation editor is the most useful, but you can do the same thing with video as well. I'll add a Gaussian blur to this clip. I'll control and right click the clip and hit Show Video Animation or press the shortcut Control V. I'll hit Option K 4 times to make 4 keyframes. I'll lower these sections on the side so we just have that blur gradually coming into play in this raised section here. Maybe I throw a title in that section of the clip since the added blur gives way to it being more visible. These animation editors allow us to see when the effect is taking place in the clip and by how much. The third thing you're doing wrong is not using the default title effect transition feature. So let's say that I use this title from this plugin all the time. If I control right click the title, I can hit Make Default Title. Now, whenever I hit Control T, think Control Title, that title will automatically be placed on the timeline. Let's say I use the sharpen effect in my effects browser all the time. I'll control right click and hit Make Default Video Effect. Then hit Option E, think Option Effect, with my clip selected, and that effect is automatically added whenever I hit that shortcut. Same with the transition that I use the most. Right click, make default, and this time it's Command T, think Command Transition. So that's Control T for title, Option E for effect, and Command T for transition. Last thing for this, you can set a default lower third as well. So I have my default lower third set up as an adjustment layer. So all I have to do is hit Control Shift T and my adjustment layer will quickly pop up. That leads us into the fourth thing you might be doing wrong, and that is not using adjustment layers in your workflow. So what are adjustment layers? Some of you might be asking. Adjustment layers are these layers that look like titles, and when you add an effect or adjust any part of them, they affect everything under them on the timeline. Everything. So for example, if I add one over my clips by pressing Control Shift T, find Custom LUTs, and select one of my own LUTs. Now I've added that LUT to all the clips underneath that adjustment layer, which really helps if you're trying to bust out color grading in a short amount of time. Using an adjustment layer is also a great way to add a letterbox if you want to bake in a letterbox to your video. And I probably use adjustment layers the most for this. I use it to scale in, rotate, and adjust the position of the entire timeline at will. And these layers are free, guys. I'll link some free adjustment layers from my buddy Dylan Bates, the Final Cut Bro, in the description. The fifth thing you're doing wrong is deciding what LUTs or effects you'd like on your clips by going through the tedious process of applying, then deleting to try another one, trying that one out, then deleting. You know how it goes. It's a lot of back and forth. But check this out. Let's say I want to add a LUT and maybe some effects to this clip, but I'm not sure which ones. I'll select a LUT and then I'll press Option Y to audition this clip. Essentially, Option Y duplicates the clip to allow you to make different changes to the clip to try out what works best. So now I will choose another LUT. Maybe I'll go with DLUT. Maybe I'll adjust the luma curve to add a bit of contrast, and I'll press Option Y again. I'll delete that curve and maybe go with Popwa here. And just for the example, I'll throw on an M-Movie Light preset. Now that we've got our look set up, press Control, Option, and either right or left arrow to immediately jump between all of your different looks. You could have 20 looks in here, guys, and this would allow you to do a nearly side-by-side comparison to help you choose the look of your video. Something I forgot to mention is that if you double-click on your clip here, you can see what exactly Audition is doing, and you can scroll through from there if you'd like more of a truly side-by-side comparison.
By the way, I realize that we've gone over a ton of keys and keyboard shortcuts in this video and in the previous video, and I can imagine that you probably feel very overwhelmed. So for those interested, I actually spent quite a lot of time and put together a cheat sheet of all my favorite Final Cut Pro shortcuts, customized keys, and different ways that I edit faster. So you can easily reference the cheat sheet while editing and then pop back into FCP to apply them. It'll cost you $0. That's right, totally free. You can just go to my website and download it. I think you'll get a ton of benefit from it. I'll put the link in the comments and in the description.
The sixth thing you're doing wrong is not using custom workspaces to help you speed up your workflow and make your FCP interface just look better and in a short amount of time. So check this out. Let's say when I color grade, I usually have my video scopes up by pressing Command 7. I usually go with the two up layout with a vector scope on top and the luma waveform on bottom. I'll usually start with my color wheels, so I'll press Command 6 and make sure those are selected. Maybe I'll make the scopes a little smaller so my viewport is bigger. I'll push down the timeline because we don't really need to have that big when color grading. And this, I would say, is my ideal color grading setup. Instead of making FCP look like this every time, which would take way too long to set up, go to Window, Workspaces, Save Workspace As, and I'll label this Color Grading Workspace. Now every time I go into my workspaces and hit this, it'll set FCP up exactly how I want it. There's tons of other options for useful layouts, though. Maybe you could set up one for editing audio, one for importing, organizing, and keywording media, and maybe even just a standard workspace for editing. The seventh thing you're doing wrong is taking unnecessary steps when trimming and cutting your footage. I've seen people do this a lot, and maybe this is you. Maybe I'm specifically talking to you right now. If you're still someone that presses Command B to make a cut, and then you select that end part that you don't want, and then you delete, stop doing that. Instead, press the shortcut Option and right bracket. This takes two steps out of deleting that section, and just trims the clip down to your skimmer. Little side note, like I talked about in part one of this video series, I used the custom keyboard shortcut editor and made this shortcut just left and right bracket. The same thing goes for the beginning of the clip. Instead of cutting and then deleting, just hit Option and left bracket, or just left bracket if you customize your keys. I can hear some of you saying, I know that shortcut, Dylan. Okay, good, that's a very useful thing to know. Here are some other tips. With the end of your clip selected, press period to extend a single frame and comma to cut a single frame. This allows you to obviously make really precise adjustments so you can fine-tune your shot. I use this shortcut every single time I'm editing. If one frame is too little for you and you like to go big, hold shift and then press period or comma. By holding shift, you extend or cut by 10 frames. Last thing, if you're someone that makes cuts and then deletes the section you don't want, speed that process up by just holding R to temporarily bring up your range tool, drag to select, and then press delete. And like we learned, once you release that R key, you'll switch back to your select tool automatically. The eighth thing you're doing wrong in Final Cut Pro is just having your voiceover or dialogue on the timeline and not adding any useful audio effects to make it sound better. Bad audio is one way to not have a good video. The two built-in tools I use all the time, every single time I edit pretty much, is the compressor, which essentially takes the quietest and loudest parts of your voice and gets it to a more even level. So if you talk quietly, it'll end up being the same volume as when you're talking at full volume. I also use the limiter to help make sure that if my voice gets too loud and peaks, it's brought down to the level of my choosing. And I also use this to supplement the compressor just to get my entire voice audio to a level I'd like it to be at. Now, I could go through and tell you the specific settings you should use, but that would add another 6 minutes onto the video. So I'll link a specific video I created on the topic and place it in the comments in the description for those interested. If you don't really care about mastering your voice audio and you just want it to sound better with a click of a button, go into your effects browser, type in voiceover enhancement, which is a free built-in effect, by the way, and double-click this to apply to your clip. From here, you can select one of these four options, as well as the amount of the effect that you'd like on your voice. Extra tidbit, if you have a lot of echo or background noise in your shot, you can use the newly added feature called voice isolation.
This is an example. I'm playing music very loudly in the background. I have a fan behind me, and this is a very echoey room.
The ninth thing you're doing wrong is thinking that the color board and the color wheels are the only useful built-in color grading tools in Final Cut. Those of you that are subscribed and watch my color grading tutorials know that I love the color curves. Say you have a shot that's too blue. You could manually select that specific blue color by heading into this drop-down menu, or you can use the color picker here. Select an area of the shot, and the color curve will not only change to the color of that selection, but it'll also place this line here, which corresponds to how bright that selection point is. Shadows at the bottom of the curve, highlights at the top, and midtones in the middle. If I just pull down on the curve, I can get rid of some of that cyan to help balance out the shot. Quick bonus tip here, if you hold down Option when dragging, it'll help you to make a much slower adjustment, similar to how Command and drag for audio volume helps you to adjust the volume on your audio clips slower. That's more of a color correction example though, but the curves are also really fantastic for color grading as well. Check this out. I'll create a really quick complementary color grade by selecting cyan and orange. I'll double click the top of the inspector to extend it so we can see the curves better. I'll push some cyan into my shadows and decrease the cyan in my highlights. Basically, just tilting this curve. Then I'll do the reverse on this orange curve. I'll decrease the orange in my shadows and increase it in my highlights. Then we can go up to our luma curve, which only adjusts brightness, which is why it's just white. And I'll create what's called an S curve to help us add some contrast. And maybe I'll add a bit more orange into our midtones by pushing up here and drag this part of the curve down to lower the amount of orange in this highlight area. And now we have a really simple color grade that you made in just a few seconds. It doesn't look incredible, I know, but it's just a quick example. Bonus tip, if you want to make sure your darkest shadows and your brightest highlights look clean, open a hue sat curve, head down to luma versus sat, use the dropper to select the darkest part of your image, and I'll decrease the saturation in our darkest shadows by making a nice gradual drop off here. I'll also do the same for our very brightest highlights. And this just helps to make our color grade look cleaner, tidier, and more natural. It is a precision adjustment that you cannot do with the color wheels or the color board. The 10th thing you're doing wrong is having really messy and unorganized audio on your timeline. Do yourself a solid and use audio rolls and sub rolls. So the nice thing is, once you get these set up, you can open your index, you can move these bad boys around, you can collapse every roll except one so it's easier to see, and you can do things like mute entire rolls. This is really useful when you have big projects that have intricate sound design, but also useful if you create smaller videos. I'll right-click my music, go to Assign Audio Rolls, and select this as Music. Now for the typing and dog sounds, I'll put it in my roll that I labeled as Foley. How you make your own rolls is you hit Edit Rolls, then from here, you can hit this plus sign to add another audio roll, label it, maybe change the color if you want, and then you can select that new audio roll whenever you'd like. Like we went over, I'll head into my index and move these around. I usually like dialogue at the top, hard sound effects are Foley below that, then ambience, then music. And now we have a beautiful looking color-coded timeline that'll keep you organized and make it much easier for you to edit and make potential changes to your sound design later.
If you appreciate the work that I put into this video, do me a huge favor and leave me a comment down below letting me know that you did. And subscribe if you like this video, because I make videos just like this all the time. And hopefully I will see you guys next week. Have a great day.